We are continuing our study of Isaiah, but we're doing it through Matthew's eyes. And in Matthew's gospel, there are 10 major quotations from the book of Isaiah that are woven throughout the story. This would be an example of what technical scholars of the scriptures would call intertextuality. That is to say, two texts are being brought together for the purpose of mutual illumination and reinforcement. And so we're now seeing words that Isaiah had used in speaking to the people of his time applied in the ministry of Jesus as the fulfillment of that which Isaiah had talked about. Doesn't mean that Isaiah was simply talking about the future. He was talking to the people of his day. But as he talked to the people of his day, he was also talking about the future. And so there was a greater fulfillment yet to come. And we looked at three of those last week, beginning with the prophecy of the virgin birth in chapter 1. And now this week we are starting in chapter 8. And we have a little paragraph here, which is also in Mark's gospel, and we'll be comparing the two in just a minute, dealing with the healing ministry of Jesus. So chapter 8 at verse 14. And when Jesus entered Peter's house, he saw his mother-in-law lying sick with a fever. He touched her hand, and the fever left her. And she rose and began to serve him. That evening, they brought to him many who were oppressed by demons. And he cast out the spirits with the word and healed all who were sick. This was to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah. He took our illnesses and bore our diseases. Now, the quotation that is taken from the prophet Isaiah is in chapter 53. And the end of chapter 52 and the whole of chapter 53 is the last of the four great servant songs in the middle portion of Isaiah, chapters 40 to 55. The first one is 42. We'll be looking at that in just a minute. So the middle portion of Isaiah focuses or emphasizes Jesus as the servant of the Lord who will come, and the final and climaxing servant song, is the atonement of Jesus Christ, how he bore our sins and brought us forgiveness of sins. All we like sheep have gone astray, we have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Now, in this particular context, Matthew is actually applying it, using it, to illuminate the healing ministry of Jesus with respect to our physical illnesses. Isaiah chapter 53 puts its greatest emphasis upon our spiritual problem, our sin, the need for the forgiveness of our sins, the need for reconciliation with God. But Matthew is showing it also has an application to our physical illnesses. There is an important connection between our spiritual problem and our physical illnesses. It's not a one-to-one correspondence, so that if you're sick, you must have sinned. We have many examples in the New Testament to tell us that's not the case. The greatest, I suppose, is that of Job. Job was blameless, upright, fearing God, and turning away from evil. Yet terrible things happened to him, including the fact that he became physically quite miserable because of the sores that broke out of his body in the second wave of Satan's attack. His physical sickness, his physical problems, had nothing to do with his individual sins. There is, however, an ultimate connection between all of that. You know the difference between a proximate cause and an ultimate cause? The proximate cause is the cause that is nearest at hand. It's right next door. It's the immediate thing that brought it about. The ultimate cause is when you trace all of that back, you get to what started this whole movement. All right, well, there may not be a proximate cause. There may not be a near-to-hand cause that connects our sin and our suffering. Well, we could easily be suffering at the hands of somebody else who's sinning. There may be no immediate proximate cause between our suffering and our sin. But of course there is an ultimate cause, because had the human race not sinned, had Adam not sinned, none of us would have ever been sick. Sickness comes into the world for the same reason that there are thorns and thistles growing in gardens. It is a part of the curse that falls upon the world. We are all now exposed to death. We are all mortal creatures. If we live long enough, we'll die. If we don't live long enough, we'll still die. All of us will die because of sin, okay? But it may well be that the immediate or proximate cause of our death had nothing to do with sin. We may have died because some drunk driver ran into us, and it was his sin rather than our sin that brought about our death. But ultimately, of course, we are exposed to death, and we are exposed to illnesses because of our sin, because of Adam's sin, because our sin in the sense, not our individual sins, but the sin of the human race. Bad things happen to us because we are sinners living in a world of sin. Even though the way it plays out in time doesn't always have a proximate connection to our sin and our suffering. Many examples of suffering at the hands of other people who are sinning could be multiplied. Think of the man that was born blind. He was a puzzle to the disciples. Here's a man who's born blind. In their mind, there was always a proximate cause between your sin and your suffering. But this guy poses a problem because he was born blind, okay? Did he sin before he was born? Why was it his sin or was it his parents' sin? Jesus, well, it was neither one. This man was born blind so that the power of God may be demonstrated in his body. The glory of God would be seen in him. This man's blindness had nothing to do with his sin or with his parents' sin. Ultimately, yes, it had to do with the sin of the human race. There wouldn't be any blind people. There wouldn't be any deaf people. There wouldn't be any handicapped people. There wouldn't even be any dumb people, I think, if we hadn't sinned. But we sin. And as a result, thorns and thistles grow in our gardens, etc. Now, the connection that Matthew is making here is moving in the other direction. He is laying the groundwork for us to believe that God has power and will to save our spiritual problem or to solve our spiritual problem, and that our confidence is grounded in the fact that he can solve our physical problems. You think of another story of the man who's carried on the pallet to Jesus by four friends, and he gets let down out of the ceiling because they can't break through the crowd with all of this, and Jesus immediately says to the man, your sins are forgiven. And that sets the Pharisees off in the matter, and then Jesus deals with them, and he said, now which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or rise, take up your bed, and walk? Well, in point of fact, it's just as easy to say the one or the other. He's not talking about how easy it is to say the words. He's talking about which is easier to do. In their mind, it would have been a whole lot easier just to say your sins are forgiven. It would be a whole lot harder to actually tell the man to take up his bed and walk, and the man would do it. And so Jesus, in order that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, I say to you, rise. Take up your bed and walk. And so people there who had eyes to see and ears to hear, not like the Pharisees whose hearts were closed, they could see that Jesus can solve our spiritual problem because he just solved this man's physical problem. He made him take up his bed and walk. And a man who had to be carried in on a pallet picked up the pallet himself and walked out and went elsewhere. That is power to save. And Matthew wants to bring that. And that's a part of Matthew's story that he wants to emphasize. And one of the ways he emphasized becomes clear when you compare how he reported on this incident and how Mark reported on this incident. So don't lose your place in Matthew. Keep your finger there. But turn over to Mark chapter 1, where you get Mark's version of this episode. In connection again with the healing of Peter's mother-in-law who had a fever. If we had the time, we'd look at Luke's version of it also. Luke, the doctor, tells you that Peter's mother-in-law had a great fever. He had an interest in details that Matthew and Mark didn't have an interest in. So Luke wants you to know it was a great fever. I'm interested to meet Luke, as you can well imagine, when I get to heaven, because I've got a lot of questions about his gospel. I'm teaching his gospel. I spent the whole day in that room over there yesterday from 9 to 4:30. I let him off early. We didn't go all the way to 5. So we went there, and we were moving through Luke's gospel. And, you know, it's just amazing to get down into the weeds and to see the artistry that is involved in a man under the inspiration of God reporting to you on the work of Jesus Christ. And so I'm of the persuasion, here I'm a minority, I'm often in the minority, but as I've told you before, I believe that Matthew wrote the first gospel, despite the fact that almost the whole of the academy, conservative and liberal alike, believe that Mark wrote the first gospel. That is so widespread that people just flip it off without even thinking about it. Everybody believes it, just like we all believe that the earth now revolves around the sun. But the early church all believed that Matthew wrote first. And I happen to think their word ought to count for something in this debate. They lived a whole lot closer to it than we did. Matthew writes first, and Luke tells you, he's the only gospel writer that says anything at all that would enable you to put the four Gospels in some relative order. They normally say nothing at all that will enable you to date what they are talking about. But Luke tells you in his opening preface, inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been fulfilled among us, it seemed good to me also, having folded all things carefully from the beginning, to write it out in orderly fashion for you that you might know you, O Theophilus, that you might know the certainty of the things in which you have been instructed. He said he followed all things closely. Now that is most commonly understood to mean that he researched it thoroughly. All right, there's some evidence that could be offered in that favor. First of all, he tells you there's more gospels out there than mine. Others have already written. Okay, so if he's a researcher, he did not get the detail about the great fever for Matthew and Mark because they don't mention it. So where did he get that detail? In the same context that we're looking in, he talks about the healing of the man in the synagogue on the Sabbath day who had a withered hand. Luke tells you it was his right hand. You don't get that from Matthew and Mark. But you appreciate that in a doctor, especially a surgeon, especially if you're the patient. If it's your right hand that is to be operated on, you want him to know that. You don't want to come out of there with a cast on your left hand when your problem was in your right hand. But Luke takes notice of those things. All right. The man that had leprosy, Luke says that he was full of leprosy. Now, how did he know that? He didn't get it from Matthew and Mark because they don't report it that way. So he doesn't just go on the written sources available to him. He must have had independent source of information. All right? There's two possible ways he could have had that. Two possible ways. One, he's a very good researcher. He interviews. He follows around. As far as we know of his movements, he'd have had opportunity to do so. He was with Paul on the end of Paul's third missionary journey when they went to Jerusalem to deliver the gift that had been raised among the Gentile churches. And when Paul got there, though he was hoping to deliver the gift, then head off to Rome, then head off to Spain, things went awry. He got to Jerusalem. He gets arrested. He ends up 2 years in Caesarea. We know that Luke was with him. How do we know that Luke was with him? Because in the book of Acts, he says we. We know that Luke was with him when he went to Jerusalem, and we know that Luke was with him when he left Caesarea because of the we sections in the book of Acts. So whether he was there constantly for 2 years, Paul was in jail 2 years there, I don't know that, but he was with him when he came, he was with him when he left. For 2 years, he might have had opportunity to have a research grant and to go around and talk to the people that had known Jesus and interview them and so on, you know. I imagine to myself him sitting down with Peter and said, Peter, I have a question for you. Now, I read that your mother-in-law was healed by Jesus and that she had had a fever. That's right. Well, what kind of a fever was it? And the Galilean fisherman looks at him and he says, it was a fever. Yeah, but what kind of a fever was it? Was it a big fever or a little fever? I don't know. Well, was she sweating? Well, yeah, she was soaking. It was a big fever, Peter. In Greek, it's megapareto. All right? Mega fever. So he asked, how did he know it was the guy's right hand? Well, he's talking to people. Which hand was it? He might have been a good interviewer. And if he was, he was a very good listener because he's got some details that he did not get from his other written sources. There's another possibility. In his opening preface, he said that he had followed all things closely from the beginning. Followed them closely from the beginning. Modern scholarship is convinced that that means he followed it out with his mind. He researched it. He accurately investigated it. And it is possible that's what the word means. It's just not the most common meaning that's given to that word. The most common meaning that is given to that word is that he literally followed it physically. Or in other words, he was there. He saw it. Luke tells you, as the other gospel writers do not, that round about Jesus, round about the 12, there was a larger group of disciples. And that on one occasion at least, Jesus had sent them out just as he sent out the 12 with power to heal, cast out demons, to bring down Satan from heaven. 70. Even 72 of them, because the manuscripts differ on the number. There were 72, or 70 at least, of these other disciples who had followed around. Matthew and Mark say nothing about that group. And when you compare what Luke says about the ministry of the 12 in chapter 9, he gives it 6 verses, with what he tells you about the 70 or 72 in chapter 10, which he gives it in 2 sections, 17-some verses devoted to all of this. Why does he tell you more about the 70 than he tells you about the 12? And why does he report it as if he was right there saying, did we not? We came back with our hearts rejoicing. Yeah, he may have been a very good interviewer, I give you that. I don't think we could explain all of it by the fact that he was there, because he gives you very intimate details about Mary's conversation with an angel. We know he wasn't there. He gives you very intimate details about Zechariah and Elizabeth and what went on inside the temple. He wasn't there. But he does say he had followed all things closely from the beginning. He may have been there from the 70. So it may be that we get these details. All right, so that's kind of an introduction to Luke, and it's kind of a curious question to tease your mind to think this through. If you're really interested in it, there's a wonderful article on that by a man by the name of John Wenham. He's one of my great heroes. And Wenham wrote an article on the identification of Luke, and if you're interested in it, send me an email, and I'll send the article to you. But I want to get into something that's distinctive of Matthew's reporting on the physical illnesses today. And the contrast is between him and Mark. All right, so we've just read the story about Jesus healing many, and in Mark's gospel, we get at chapter 1, beginning at verse 29, and it says, and immediately he left the synagogue, and he entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother lay ill with a fever. Luke tells you it's a great fever. Immediately they told him about her, and he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, and the fever left her, and she began to serve them. All right, now here comes the point of contrast. You need to listen very, very closely. Pay attention to every word. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or oppressed by demons. And the whole city was gathered together at the door. And he healed many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. Matthew chapter 8, read it again. And when Jesus entered Peter's house, He saw his mother-in-law lying sick with a fever. He touched her hand, and the fever left her until she rose and began to serve him. That evening they brought to him many who were oppressed by demons, and he cast out the spirits with the word, and he healed all who were sick. This was to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah. He took our illnesses and bore our diseases. What's the difference between the two reports? One doesn't contradict the other, but they do report things differently. Emphasis is put on something different in each of them. Just a difference in emphasis. It's not a contradictory report. All right? These are perfectly harmonious with one another, but it's looking at an event from this side, and it's looking at an event from this side. And Matthew wants to make one point out of this that Mark is not interested in making. So Mark phrases it one way, and Matthew phrases it another way. What was the difference? All and many. Who heard it? Very good. Go to the head of the class. In Mark's gospel, he said, they brought him all who were sick, and he healed many. Now, Mark doesn't mean that they brought him all and he only healed some. That's not what he said. When he said he healed many, he meant there were many people that healed. When he said they brought all who were oppressed, he didn't mean every sick person throughout the whole region had been brought. He meant it in the same way that we said, there was a football game the other night and everybody went. Everybody didn't go, okay? Not everybody gets a ticket. What do we seat down there? 80,000 people in the stadium, all right? 80,000 people might have been there. But there's a lot more people in Columbia. But people might say, everybody went to the game. Everybody was there, but not everybody was there. All right? It's just a way of speaking. It's like at the beginning of Mark's gospel when John the Baptist begins his ministry. He says, all who were in Judea, Jerusalem, went out to be baptized by John in the Jordan River. All right? How many of you have read Mark's gospel, chapter 1? All right, put them up there. Have you read Mark, chapter 1? All right. Is there anyone here who, upon reading Mark chapter 1, concluded that every single man, woman, and child in Judea had been baptized by John in the Jordan River? No. Why? That's not the intent. It's just a way of talking about a lot. So when he said they were all who were oppressed, he means a lot of people were oppressed and they were brought. And he healed many, meaning by that there were a lot of people healed. It doesn't mean he healed only some, but Matthew puts it differently. And it turns out to be something that's characteristic of his reporting on this. They brought to him many, and he healed them all. To let you know, there's not a single problem that ever came to him that he couldn't solve. If he were a doctor, there was not a case that ever came to him that he didn't succeed in. They brought him many, and they were all healed. As I say, it's part of Matthew's characteristic way of reporting. Look at chapter 4. We get a little summary of the teaching ministry of Jesus, or the public ministry of Jesus. Matthew chapter 4, verse 23. And he went throughout all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every disease and every affliction among the people. Now, he could have said the same thing if he had only used the word every, pasa in Greek, one time. He could have said every disease and affliction. It would have meant exactly the same thing. But when he decides to use that word twice, it's putting emphasis on it. Every disease and every affliction. In other words, he's letting you know he really does mean this literally. He's not using this just as a part of common speech. All went out to be baptized. He's really meaning it, that every single disease, every single affliction was healed by him. He doesn't just do it once. He does it again. Matthew chapter 9, we get the same summary of his ministry. End of the chapter, verse 35. And Jesus went throughout all their cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every disease and every affliction. Every disease and every affliction. When he sent out his disciples in chapter 10, we've referred to. He called them, verse 1, he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. Now, obviously, this is a point Matthew wants to make. He's using an emphatic description three times over. And he uses another, equally emphatic, when he describes the healing ministry after the healing of Peter's mother-in-law. They brought him many, and he healed them all. Now, in the lifetime of Jesus, it is not true that every single sick person in the world was healed. It wasn't even true that every single Christian person in the world was healed. But the healing ministry of Jesus was intended to let you know that is going to happen. If it hasn't happened yet in your life as a believer, it will. Because when the kingdom of heaven comes in its fullness, this is but the foretaste. When the kingdom of heaven comes in its fullness, he will indeed heal every disease and every affliction. When we get to heaven, there will no longer be any death, neither mourning nor crying nor pain anymore. Every single affliction will be gone. I can't wait to see what I look like. All right? Because I've lived under the affliction of this. All right? I remember when I was in eighth grade, I really had this crush on this girl and whatnot. Back in the days where, you know, it would take an awful lot to actually express it and whatnot. So what do? Okay, if you don't have the courage to get up and say it, what would you do? You write a note and do what? You pass it to her? No, I didn't even do that. I gave it to her friend to give to her. All right, the answer came back through the friend. I wouldn't waste my time. I've lived under that crushing blow all of my life. All of my life. I wouldn't waste my time. But many of you have problems that are far more serious than that. Disabilities that are far more difficult to live with in life. And if you don't have them now, some of us are going to have them before we die. We may end up very, very different than the way we are now. So that people would have to carry us into a room to hear a Bible study, like four men who had carried the man on the pallet who was paralyzed. We may have that in this world, but we will not have that forever. There is coming a day when every disease and every affliction will be healed by the Lord Jesus Christ. Every single one. And in order that you may have hope that it is so, he's already done it once. All right? The healing ministry of Jesus was kind of like the spies bringing out of the land of Canaan the fruit that had grown there. Israel was still living in the wilderness. They're still living off manna every day. Manna. It's fairly versatile. You can boil it, you can bake it, you can roast it on a fire. At the end of the day, it's manna, okay? And you know what the meaning of the word is. What is it? That's the profound Hebrew etymology for manna. They looked upon it and they said, what is it? And they said, that's what it is. It's manna. 40 years, manna. But there they were at Kadesh Barnea, and the spies had gone in. And they had been told it was a land that flowed with milk and honey. And to bring proof out of that land, they cut off bunches of grapes and they had to string them up on a pole and carry them on the shoulders of the men who came out. And they're saying, this is the fruit that grows in the land. Now, I don't know who the elect few were that were able to eat that fruit that they brought into the can. into the camp. I imagine Moses got himself a bite. Joshua and Caleb, I trust, got a bite. Maybe they had already had a bite while they were there. A few other people would have gotten a bite. But for most people, they just saw the fruit of the promised land. It was a testimony to what was ahead. And there in the wilderness, when they lived only on manna, they ate of the promised fruit of the land of Canaan. And that's what happens when healing comes into our lives now. But it's just the sample. But the sample is there to let you know he can do it. It's there to give our faith a grounding and an assurance that his word can be trusted. And that was something that Matthew wanted to stress. He was, after all, a tax collector. He was a guy that was used to keeping accounts. And he wanted you to know that when the tally comes up, he heals every disease and every affliction. Nothing is going to carry over from your deficit into the kingdom of heaven. Not a single thing. Every disease and every affliction. And it's all tied in Isaiah chapter 53 to his atoning work. When he died upon the cross, he didn't just purchase your way out of hell. He didn't just purchase your way into heaven. He purchased for you a body and soul free from every tinge of sin and curse. You'll all be glad to look at yourself in the mirror. You'll all be glad to, like the man healed at the temple when Peter and John had gone up. They didn't have any money to give to him, but what they had, they gave to him. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, take up your bed. And he went walking and leaping and praising God. That's another one of Luke's report. And when Luke reports on it, Peter looked at him and told him to pick up his bed. And Luke reports it. He says, and immediately his ankles and his feet were strengthened. You get the camera slowed down. It's not just, and immediately he jumped up and left. No, no. Immediately his ankles and his feet were strengthened, and he began to walk, and then he began to walk and leap and praise God. And he walks you through the slow motion camera. It's kind of like Chariots of Fire, you know. When he really throws his head back, the camera slows down. And you see it. Luke slows it down, and you see it, you know. You can just see Steven Spielberg taking a scene like that, you know, and you just see the legs begin to straighten out, and, you know, the feet move into a proper position, and he begins to stand, and it's, oh, and then, boom, he's going. That's what he's going to do. It's all grounded in the atoning work. The greater work, of course, is that he forgives our sins, yes, indeed. But he's purchased wholeness for our life. Wholeness. Okay, let's go to chapter 12. I said I'd get to another servant song. I don't have a lot of time for it, but we've spent a good bit of time on this when we did Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 12, more controversies with the religious leaders. The issue about his lordship over the Sabbath opens the chapter, and then we get the story of the man with the withered hand, the right hand, according to Luke. And when the man stretched it out, this is verse 13. Then he said to the man, stretch out your hand. The man stretched it out, and it was restored, healthy like the other. But the Pharisees went out and conspired against him how to destroy him. Jesus, aware of this, withdrew from there, and many followed them, and he healed them. He healed them all and ordered them not to make him known. This was to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah. You see, you get a factual report of what happened, what Jesus said, what he did. Now you get a context in which to put it. This is what Isaiah was talking about. Behold my servant whom I have chosen, my beloved, with whom my soul is well pleased. I will put my spirit upon him, and he will proclaim justice to the Gentiles. He will not quarrel or cry aloud, nor will anyone hear his voice in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smoldering wick he will not quench, until he brings justice to victory, and in his name the Gentiles will hope. This great ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ in calling the nations, fulfilling the promise that God had made to Abraham, that he would make Abraham's seed a blessing to all the nations, is now being manifested by what Jesus is doing in the course of his life. He makes the Sabbath what it ought to be. He makes people what they ought to be. Heals the man with the withered hand. In the next section, he's going to cast out a demon. He's going to deliver people from the dominion of Satan, bring them into the kingdom of God, dear Son. How is all this happening? How does he get this power? The Spirit of the Lord is upon him. The Spirit has anointed him, and he will not fail or be discouraged until he has brought this to victory. In him, the Gentiles will hope. We've talked about the fact that he heals every disease and every affliction. Now Matthew is stressing the fact it is offered to everyone. It is offered to all the nations. It is not just to the Jews. It is for whoever calls upon the name of the Lord at whatever time in life they call upon the name of the Lord. At the end of however many sins they have committed and lived in for many years, at the end of all the aggravations of sin that they have committed through the years, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. And we know this because God put his seal upon this man. The Spirit of God was upon him in order that he might go into the world to accomplish the plan of God. And he will not be finished if it is just for Israel. As Isaiah said, we talked about this, it is too small a thing that I should make you only the Savior of Israel. I will make you a light to all the nations. And Matthew's picking up on it here. Every disease, every affliction, he heals them all from all the nations. Wow. What a Savior. It offers hope to every single soul on the planet, wherever they are, in whatever condition, whatever they've done, for however long they have done it, he offers them hope. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, and will be saved completely. Wow. That will preach. Let's pray. Lord, how we thank you for this Savior that you have given us. We thank you for the great power that was given to him, the authority which is his. But we also thank you, Lord, that he had the fullness of your heart, and that he extends his power and authority in order to call people to himself from every nation under heaven. Oh, Lord our God, help us more and more to love him and serve him with the fullness of our lives, for he is worthy of all power, authority, dominion, wealth, and riches, and honor, and power, and glory. Oh, Lord our God, help us to serve him in a manner worthy of his name. We ask it through him. Amen.